Now this time, children in preschool through kindergarten are dismissed for children's church. If you have your Bibles, we will be looking at a number of Paul's epistles, and we'll be beginning in the book of Colossians, chapter 4. And Sarah, my apologies. When you sent the list of songs, I saw "I Speak Jesus." You may have not known, but someone knew. God is good. Well, as we come to the word this morning, let's do so in prayer. Father, we thank you that we speak the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Father, there is power in the word that you have given us, not only the written word, but in the living word. Father, we ask that you would speak to us from its pages. We thank you that you are a God that loves us enough to talk to us. And you talk to us in so many ways, but above all, through your word. Father, give us ears to hear this day. Give us hearts to respond in a way that brings glory and honor to you. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it was just under a year ago that we gathered here on a Sunday morning and we celebrated 30 years of pastoral ministry. And I'd forgotten, but Rhonda reminded me that the song that she had requested for the service was the song "Find Us Faithful." And a copy of the Dewey Ladies Quartet was unearthed, and it was played as we entered into worship that morning. And if you're not familiar with the song, or if you need reminded of it, the lyrics go like this. We're pilgrims on the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. I love that picture, don't you? We're on the road, and there's people along the road cheering us on, encouraging us along the way, and their lives in Christ remind us of God's sustaining grace all along the journey. It goes on. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe. And the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. These words stood as our heart's desire then a year ago, and they continue to do so now. And that, I trust, is the desire and the result of each one of our lives who claim the name of Christ. That our devotion to Christ will light the way for someone else. That those who come behind us will have found us faithful. And the lives that we live will inspire others to walk with Christ and to obey Christ. Well, while one would hope that this is the desire of every follower of Jesus, unfortunately, it doesn't always turn out that way. Some who begin with Jesus don't end up with Jesus. One biblical example of a Christian who wasn't found to be faithful by those who came behind him was a man named Demas. Now, he's not a person that we know much about in Scripture. He may not be that may be a name you've never heard before. But Demas is mentioned three times by the Apostle Paul in the New Testament. Two times he's mentioned with commendation. And one time, the last mention of Demas is spoken with sadness. The picture of Demas painted for us in the New Testament reminds us of this, that the foremost desire of the Christian, of the follower of Christ, is to remain faithful to Jesus to the very end of life's journey. To the very end. We remain faithful. Well, the New Testament depiction of Demas points us to three aspects of his life which bear the attention and which bear the reflection of every follower of Christ. And so we want to do that this morning. And the first thing that we notice from Paul's writing and Demas' three mentions is this, that we notice Demas' apparent faith in Christ. Apparent faith. Twice in Paul's prison epistles, those were Paul's letters that he wrote while he was in prison in Rome. He, recall, had accusations made against him. And though he was in Palestine, he knew that he wouldn't get a good, fair trial there in the Jewish courts. So as a Roman citizen, it was his prerogative to appeal his case to the highest court, to Caesar himself. And so he did that, and he finds himself under house arrest for about 2 years in Rome, waiting for his trial to come about so that he could make his case. Well, as he was writing there, as he was living there, as he redeemed the time, and it was in his letter to the Colossian church that he speaks first of Demas. Colossians chapter 4, verse 14. He writes, Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Now Demas has a place in Paul's circle of friends and associates, and by all appearances, he belongs in Paul's circle of fellow believers in Christ. Now, I never want to be too dogmatic about the nature of a person's relationship to Jesus, because like Samuel, as human beings, all we can do is look at the outward appearance, and we're unable, like God is, to look upon the heart. But Scripture does give indication that it's possible for a person to give every appearance of having crossed the line of faith in Jesus without that person actually ever having done so. You can look like a Christian. You can present yourself as a Christian, as a follower of Christ, without ever crossing the line of faith in Jesus. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 through 6, is much debated, and often it's a heated debate. It's a passage that says this, "For it is impossible that the case of those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted of the heavenly gift, and have shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the goodness of the Word of God, and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away to restore them again to repentance since or while they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding him up in contempt." The matter of debate is this. Does this describe a true believer who has crossed the line of faith in Christ and then falls away? Or does it describe a person who has had every advantage of faith and who for a time gives the appearance of having followed Christ, yet who never actually crosses that line of faith in Jesus? My understanding of the text is the latter. The writer of Hebrews is issuing a very stern warning to people who have been exposed to the truths of Christ, but have never truly committed to him. Notice the language of verses in verses 4 and 5. It's highly unusual language. It contains phrases that aren't used anywhere else in the New Testament to describe true believers in Jesus. The writer of Hebrews talks about those who have once been enlightened. They know the truth about Jesus, about sin and salvation. They're not ignorant of those things. And he says, those who have tasted of the heavenly gift. Now, this is some pretty imprecise language, but at least it points to God's good gifts. They have seen and experienced God's hand of blessing. At least they've seen it in the lives of others. Perhaps they've experienced God's blessing in their own lives. And those described are those who have shared in the Holy Spirit. Shared in the Holy Spirit. It doesn't say they were indwelt with the Holy Spirit. We're told in Scripture that when we place our faith in Christ, when we cross that line of faith, The Holy Spirit indwells us. He takes up residency within us. And so the people that the writer is describing, they shared in the Holy Spirit. Perhaps they'd seen the work of the Spirit in and through the lives of true believers. They've seen what God can do. And he talks about those who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God. They had heard the Word of God taught and preached. And it says they have tasted the powers of the age to come. They've seen the hand of God at work in the lives of other people. They know what God can do. The writer warns that those who have been so exposed to the truth, but yet who haven't yet embraced it as their own, they place themselves in a perilous position of hardening themselves to the truth irreversibly. To reject Christ after so much exposure to him through his word and through his people is to place oneself alongside those who crucified Christ. Some of the hardest hearts I've encountered belong to people who know the truth but have never made it their own. When I was in seminary, I had a professor, Dr. Walter Kaiser, and he told the story about his time in seminary. He was actually a graduate school, Brandeis University. A seminary out east, and it wasn't necessarily an evangelical seminary. It had sort of a Jewish branch and it had a Christian branch, but the Christian branch was liberal in nature. Well, he was in a class on the book of Romans taught by a Dr. Goodenough. And Dr. Goodenough, Dr. Kaiser says, he was speaking of the book of Romans, the wonders of justification through faith in Christ. And he was talking about the sanctification of the believer through the power of the Holy Spirit. And he was talking about how man's sin was imputed, was placed upon Christ, and Christ's righteousness is placed upon those who place their faith in Christ. And so he was talking about Paul's argument in the book of Romans. And finally, there was a student in the class that raised his hand and said, "Dr. Goodenough, I didn't think you believed all this." Dr. Goodenough's response was, "That's what Paul believed, not what I believe." See, he knew it, but he'd never been changed by it, or embraced it, or been transformed by the truth of the Word of God. Notice, though, impossible to restore them again to repentance while they're continuing to walk away from Christ. It's not the end of the story, necessarily. Well, the question is, had Demas? We can't know for certain, and neither could the Apostle Paul, but he apparently knew enough about the Christian faith that if he wasn't a true believer, he was able, at least for a season, to fool Paul. So that's the first thing we notice about him. He was his apparent faith in Christ. The second thing we learn about Demas was, while he had apparent faith in Christ, he had real service to Christ. The second passage in Paul's writing which mentions Demas is the book of Philemon, again, one of the prison epistles, again, written while Paul was waiting for his appeal to come, his case to come before Caesar. And so he wrote a personal letter to a personal friend. And at the end of the letter, he says this: "Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus." Epaphras was in, if not Paul's same jail cell, at least he was in jail with Paul. "Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greeting to you, and so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers." Fellow workers. While Paul was in prison, he had a whole cadre. He had a band of brothers who, though on the outside of the prison bars, were right there with him. They, along with Paul, were working for the advancement of the gospel, for the advancement of the church of Jesus Christ. They were proclaiming the good news that Christ died on the cross in our place for our sins. Now just take a moment to look over the list of the fellow workers that Paul mentions by name in this verse. There is Mark, his fellow worker. This was the one-time washout of Fellowship Worker University. He had abandoned Paul and Barnabas on their first missionary journey. And Paul said, I have no longer any use for someone like Mark. But now as Paul has come to the end of his life, or is near the end of his life, he says, Mark is useful to me for ministry. Mark was the one who was a close companion of the Apostle Peter. Most believe that the Gospel of Mark that bears his name is basically a summary of Peter's preaching ministry. Mark, who was once disparaged by Paul, was now very useful. So Mark, a fellow worker. And then there's Aristarchus. Now, we don't know that much about Aristarchus, but this is the one thing we do know, that in the churches of northern Greece, there had been an offering taken among the churches because they had heard that there was a famine in Jerusalem, and the believers in Christ in Jerusalem, they were having a hard time. And so Paul received an offering in the churches of northern Greece to take to Jerusalem to distribute among those who were suffering. And the person who was entrusted to go with Paul, with the coins, with the money, was Aristarchus. We trust Aristarchus with the money bag. We know he is a man of integrity, a godly man that can be entrusted with this task. So that's Aristarchus, a fellow worker. And then there is Luke, Paul's beloved physician. Paul's traveling companion on several of Paul's mission trips. This is the Luke who is the author of the Gospel of Luke and of the book of Acts, and some would argue the author of the book of Hebrews. A fellow worker. Now we widen our window on the New Testament away from these two single verses, and we discover other notables counted among Paul's fellow workers. Timothy, Aquila and Priscilla, Titus, and others. And as he writes this letter, Paul shows no hesitancy to place Demas in that same pantheon, that same group of respected and faithful servants of Christ. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, send greetings to you. And so do Mark and Aristarchus and Demas and Luke, my fellow workers. He lended. He gave real service to the cross of Christ and to the cause of Christ. The third aspect of Demas' life that we discover in Paul's writings is Demas' sobering abandonment of Christ. Paul's third mention of Demas comes to us in his second letter to Timothy. Now, to understand Paul's words here about Demas, we need to understand a little bit about when and why 2 Timothy was written. Paul is again in prison. This could be counted a prison epistle, except that this was not during his house arrest in Rome when he wrote the other letters. This was when he found himself once again in a Roman prison cell. He knew this time was not going to end with the door unlocked and walking out the door. It wasn't going to result in freedom. He knew that. This was going to result in his death. And so he's at the end of the life. He's saying, I'm already being poured out like a drink offering. He says, my departure is near. And he's not talking about his departure from his prison cell. He's talking about his departure from this world. He knows the end is near of his physical life on earth. And as he's coming to the end, and as he is recognizing that, he's left alone, and he's lonely. And so he writes 2 Timothy to say, Timothy, my son in the faith, come quickly. I need you. Timothy, do your best to come to me soon. Timothy, do your best to come before winter. Paul knows that winter is coming and that death is looming, and he wants Timothy by his side. Which makes these words regarding Demas all the more gut-wrenching. He writes, "Do your best to come to me soon, quickly. Make haste to come to me. Get here, Timothy, as fast as you can. For, because, here's why I need you, Timothy. Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica." Paul's alone. Demas has deserted him. That word deserted, it's a word that's used relatively infrequently in the New Testament. Though one use of it, on one occasion, is very familiar to us. Recall Jesus on the cross. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you, what? Forsaken me. Same word. In both cases, the word communicates the complete desertion of someone who is in a situation where aid and help is desperately needed. See, what Paul needed Demas when he needed him most. Demas was ill, absent, without leave. He's deserted me. I need you, Timothy. He's gone to Thessalonica. Now, Demas had been in Rome with Paul, and now he wasn't. He went to Thessalonica. We don't know why he chose to go there. Maybe it was his hometown. Maybe he said, "I'm going home." So we don't know why he went to Thessalonica, but we do know why he left Paul. And why he, by all appearances, abandoned Christ. Because of this, he was in love with the present world. Ultimately, like the rich young ruler before him, Demas didn't love Jesus with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength. The cost of discipleship, the cost of following Jesus was too high. The demands of following Jesus were too rigorous. The blessings of following Jesus in Demas' mind were outweighed by the burden of obeying him. Demas' love for that which this world could give him surpassed that which he felt Jesus could give him. Demas' love for Christ grew cold. So he left Paul and beat Jesus behind and pursued that which in his estimation offered him a better, more pleasant, more comfortable deal. And Demas decided, "I'm done. I'm done." And from that moment on, those who came behind Demas didn't find him faithful. Don't be deceived. The struggle is real. The temptation is great. The path called wandering and abandonment of Christ is a well-worn path. And so this warning is sounded by the Apostle John in his first letter. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life, these things are not from the Father but from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. Demas traded the temporal for the eternal. Temporal pleasures outweighed in his mind, in his heart, eternal pleasures at God's right hand. May we not be so foolish. I'm not sure when I first heard the song. The title is, "I've Decided to Make Jesus My Choice." The road is rough. The going gets tough. and the hills are hard to climb. I started out a long time ago. There is no doubt in my mind. I have decided to make Jesus my choice. Demas, to his detriment, did not make that choice. He loved what the world offered to him more than what Jesus offered to him. Oh, may we, as followers of Jesus, who claim the name of Christ, be sobered by Demas' choice. Be sobered by his weariness in well-doing. Be sobered by his running after a false god that in the end could not offer him anything which was ultimately satisfying or life-giving or of eternal value. Oh, may we learn from Demas, and may we not follow in his footsteps. The foremost desire of the Christian, of the true follower of Christ, is to remain faithful to Jesus to the very end of life's journey. Of this, Demas was the unmodel. When after seemingly beginning with Jesus, he got off track and followed his heart, which led him not to Jesus, but ultimately away from him. Of people such as Demas, Jesus had something to say. In a little story he told about the parable of a sower, the seed of the word of God is planted. It falls on all sorts of different types of soil, all different types of hearts. And of one heart, he says, as for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, like Demas, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, making it unfruitful. And ultimately, like Demas, those that Jesus speaks of, they come to the place where they say, I'm done. I will go a different path, a different direction. Oh, but may we be, and may every one of us here this morning, may we be of better seed. May we be counted among those who agree with the songwriter. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords, offers today. Would you pray with me? Father, the apostle has written that all these things were written as instructions and examples and warnings to us. Father, may we heed well the warning of Demas' life and experience and the parent faith for a season, real service, but ultimately a heart that was far from you and far from Jesus. Oh, Father, may we not be of that ilk. Father, may we not be of that kind. But Father, may we be of the kind that love the Lord our God and our Savior Jesus with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love you to the very end, to our last breath on earth, that we may be in your presence for our first breath in heaven. Father, may each one of us be able to say with the songwriter with full assurance and full honesty, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world has to give me. Father, may that be our prayer. Father, see us by the presence, the indwelling of your Holy Spirit, to the end of life's journey, that we may one day rejoice in your presence. And hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter now into the joy of your master. Father, this is our prayer. Father, in our own strength, we can't do it. But by your power and the power of your Holy Spirit, nothing is impossible. And so we look to you for strength, for wisdom, to take us home. Father, this is our prayer, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd rather have Jesus. Would you stand as we sing those words together? Jesus than anything this world affords, offers today. And all Jesus friends, and all God's people said, amen. Go in peace. God's blessing upon you.